Within the past few million years, the planet Tira 292b has seen the evolution of the Neotects, the first clade in the planet's history to evolve obligate sapience, having reached the point of becoming completely reliant on their technology to survive. And with their unprecedented capacity to imagine and invent new behaviors, they're now poised to spread across the planet and proliferate into countless thousands of different cultures. Before we begin, it's important to note that while geography and environmental factors can certainly influence culture, they don't completely define it, and the specific way that culture develops can't be precisely predicted by any formula or algorithm, so consider everything that we discuss in this video only as very broad guidelines, and keep in mind that there are always exceptions to every rule. A prime example of this is the notion that there exists a clear and rigid divide between hunter-gatherer and agricultural societies, the former usually being conceived of as nomadic, living in loosely associated bands at low population densities, having egalitarian social structures with no stratification or division of labor, and building no permanent dwellings, monuments, or structures of any kind. While agriculture is often thought of as going hand in hand with a sedentary lifestyle, high population densities, complex social hierarchies, and urbanization. In reality, however, this is a false dichotomy and a huge oversimplification, and ignores the enormous spectrum of other lifestyles that can be found across human cultures, let alone those of other sophonts. In this video, we'll explore just a few of the ways that non-agricultural societies can operate by looking at some of the cultures that developed during the Neotect's early history. The first Neotect societies came about in the southern expanses of arid steppe and rocky badlands, where the patchy distribution of resources forced kinship groups to work together to construct communal fortresses around fertile patches of the otherwise barren landscape, only moving on to new territories once the local resources were exhausted. Being tied to a single, small, fixed territory will mean that most early Neotet societies will be much less mobile than those of humans, and that their expansion across the planet will occur much more gradually. But as they move into regions where resources are more evenly distributed, they'll make use of their unrivaled ability to modify their behavior to imagine and invent new life ways that are better suited to the environments they find themselves in. Several hundred thousand years before the appearance of Neotecton Acumenes, Neotecton gracilis will evolve from earlier Neotect species that migrate into temperate and tropical latitudes. And although the timescale involved will be minuscule in terms of the rate of evolutionary change, Neotecton gracilis will still manage to undergo a minor degree of adaptation to make them marginally more tolerant of warm climates than other Neotect species, such as slightly smaller bodies, longer legs, and shorter, sparser fur. And while Neotecton acumenes will go on to see the most success of all the Neotect species, some populations of Neotecton gracilis will still survive, at least for now, in the southwestern corner of the supercontinent, separated from the rest of the continent by a mountain range with a vast desert on its eastern side. Much of the western side of these mountains will also experience an arid climate, as well as extreme seasonal variation, with dry winters that can fall below freezing and hot summers of up to 30 degrees Celsius that bring sporadic rainfall, creating an expanse of cold desert and steppe ringed by continental climate zones dotted with groves of notophytes and drought-resistant xylophytes, as well as trilophytes, cryptophytes, and other seasonal vegetation, and home to large game like teleopsids, pachycolophorans, and various prosecoforms. In landscapes like this, where resources are widely scattered and transient, many cultures of Neotecton gracilis will be nomadic, constantly moving to new areas in search of food and water. Compared to humans, Neotects have a relatively poor spatial memory and sense of direction, so the nomadic Neotect cultures will be more reliant on external navigation aids, not only creating maps and mnemonics based on the stars and geographic landmarks, but also marking their migration paths with rock art, which will also play a fundamental role in their social dynamics, since for the Neotects, especially the males, architecture serves as a crucial means of social interaction and self-expression. As such, the territories of many cultures will be adorned with elaborate geoglyphs decorated with intricate designs that depict the histories of the individuals that created them. Many nomadic societies also vary their degree of mobility and their foraging habits based on the seasons as the relative abundance of resources across the landscape changes. The Great Basin Shoshone, who inhabited the Reese River Valley, spent the winters in the mountains, where they would gather pine nuts and hunt bighorn sheep and deer. But with the approach of spring, they would move down into the valley to gather the new growth of seeds, roots, and tubers. And the Hadza traditionally travel and forage over great distances during the rainy season, while water and edible plants are comparatively plentiful, whereas during the dry season, their movements are restricted to territories they establish around lasting water sources, and the prevalence of meat in their diet increases as they rely more on the game that the water holes attract. Many cultures of Neotecton gracilis that inhabit the desert and the surrounding patches of steppe will operate in a similar fashion, spending the dry winters along the banks of the few rivers that flow down from the mountains while traveling over much wider areas during the comparatively wet summers. Just as on Earth, mobile cultures like these will benefit from technologies that make building, disassembling, and transporting their dwellings and all their essential supplies as easy as possible, such as tents and other collapsible structures with lightweight frames. In places where the seasonal changes in rainfall and food sources are predictable, many nomadic cultures routinely travel back and forth along established routes between two or more seasonal territories. During the summer, the oceanic moisture carried by winds that blow from the southwest will fall as orographic rains along the windward slopes of the mountains, bringing about a period of relative abundance across the highlands, which will encourage many nomadic cultures to establish summer territories within the foothills, moving back into the warmer lowlands during the winter. Since they return to the same territories on a seasonal basis, these cultures can afford to establish more or less permanent fortresses at these sites that they only inhabit for part of the year, supplemented by secondary dwellings or camps along their migration paths. Meanwhile, the regions along the coast will experience much wetter climates, those below about 40 degrees south latitude seeing high levels of rainfall throughout the year, an environment that may offer enough food and water to allow some cultures to adopt a more sedentary lifestyle. Although it's important to note that relatively few early cultures will be wholly dedicated to either nomadism or sedentism, most being capable of transitioning from one to the other in accordance with fluctuations in local conditions. However, sedentism need not go hand in hand with agriculture. Many sedentary cultures throughout human history never developed agriculture at all. One particularly striking example being the cultures of the Pacific Northwest coast of North America, who, despite being well aware of the existence of agriculture, being in regular contact with other societies that cultivated maize, never felt the need to adopt any agricultural practices themselves, as they were evidently able to harvest enough resources through hunting, gathering, and fishing to sustain their settlements, which is especially impressive considering that this region was one of the most densely populated areas of pre-Columbian North America, home to over 100,000 people at its height. One major factor that helps make this kind of non-agricultural sedentary lifestyle feasible is having access to as many different food sources in the local area as possible, so that if one resource becomes scarce, there are many others to fall back on, reducing the need to move to new areas in search of more resources. For the builders of Poverty Point, an ancient non-agricultural settlement in the lower Mississippi basin, the nearby Bayou macon and the surrounding wetlands provided a wide variety of edible plant and game species, such as fruit, nuts, deer, rabbits, possums, waterfowl, fish, and turtles. Environments that offer a suitable breadth of sustenance options are most likely to occur in places where multiple ecosystems or climate zones overlap. The cultures of the Pacific Northwest are distributed across a blend of oceanic and Mediterranean climate zones, the high rainfall along the coasts fueling the growth of the largest temperate rainforest on Earth, which transitions to dense conifer forests and prairies in the regions of drier summers around the margins of the Salish Sea. In the southeastern corner of the supercontinent, around 30 to 45 degrees south latitude, the seasonal extremes of the continental interior are moderated by the proximity of the ocean, creating a band of milder temperate and continental climate zones along the coast, as well as many pockets of microclimates that vary significantly across short distances, from humid jungles of zygodendrons in the northern lowlands to groves of alpine notophytes along the craggy mountain slopes to stretches of gallery forests and plains in the drier areas to the west. Such a variable landscape will prompt some cultures of Neotecton Acumenes to establish settlements here and adopt a largely sedentary lifestyle. Even with so many food sources in their territory, there will still be occasional fluctuations in climate and changes in the availability of edible plant and prey species that will result in periods of relative scarcity. So sedentary cultures will need to find ways of achieving a sufficient level of food security to ensure that they can make it through these periods. One essential component of this is developing means of preserving and storing food so that it can be saved for times when other food isn't available. Although food preservation methods are by no means exclusive to sedentary societies, they do allow for much more efficient exploitation of local food sources, which will be crucial for a sedentary lifestyle. Even though the Neotects are better adapted to eat rotten food than humans, meat taken from a fresh kill will still ordinarily decay to the point of becoming inedible within days, but if it can be smoked and dried quickly enough, it can stay edible for many months. As for plants, the Neotects tend much more towards carnivory than humans, with fruit and leafy vegetation being virtually absent from their diet, so most Neotect societies will obtain much more of their food from hunting than from gathering. But they'll still occasionally go for seeds, roots, and tubers to supplement their diet. Some of the most ideal plants to gather will be those with large and hardy seeds and tubers that are adapted to endure seasonal droughts, which will not only be especially nutrient-rich, but will also naturally last for long periods after they've been gathered. This food will also need to be stored properly inside vessels or containers, which can be as simple as pits dug into the ground, or can include baskets, boxes, or, if the culture has access to suitable sources of clay, pottery. Along with these technologies, the southeastern Neotet cultures will dig out special storage chambers delved into the lower levels of their dwellings to serve as stockpiles for the cold winters. Whereas in the earliest Neotet societies, each clan built and lived within its own individual fortress, in later cultures, many different clans will live in close association with each other, combining their fortresses together into villages of complex, intertwined architecture organized around communal living spaces. Contrary to another common misconception, the construction of large-scale architecture and monuments is not at all exclusive to agricultural societies, a well-known counterexample being Göbekli Tepe, one of the oldest megalithic sites on Earth, built around 9,500 to 8,000 BCE by sedentary hunter-gatherers, and Poverty Point, constructed by indigenous non-agricultural peoples between about 1700 to 1100 BCE, may well have been the largest settlement in North America at the time it was built, consisting of concentric semicircular earthen rings spanning over a kilometer in diameter, and dotted with mounds up to 20 meters tall. The Neotects, to whom architecture is an innate aspect of their social behavior, will have an especially notable propensity to transform the landscape around them, which in the sedentary southeastern cultures will manifest as earthworks and monolithic structures along the hilltops, used not only for ceremonial but also astronomical purposes, helping them track the passage of the seasons and the subsequent changes in the availability of plant and game species. But while having access to many different food sources is crucial for non-agricultural sedentary societies, one category of foods that's likely to comprise the majority of their diet is aquatic organisms. The Pacific Northwest cultures obtained a significant portion of their nutrition from salmon runs, since salmon regularly swim upriver to spawn during the autumn, providing a predictable and reliable food source, while the nearby coast hosts an abundance of other fish, as well as mollusks, seals, and whales. On the southwestern coast of pre-Columbian Florida, the Calusa were able to sustain a stratified society of over 10,000 inhabitants on a diet of fish, crabs, shellfish, and numerous other aquatic species that thrived in the surrounding mangroves. And the Mississippi Delta, where the Poverty Point culture settled, supports the highest density and diversity of fish of any river basin in North America. Societies like these, that rely heavily on aquaculture and mariculture, can derive as much as 90% of their calories from aquatic species. As such, any areas where aquatic food sources are readily and regularly available are some of the most likely to see the emergence of sedentary societies. Within about 30 degrees of the equator, the easterly winds blow more or less parallel to the cold currents that flank the supercontinent's western coast, resulting in upwelling that brings nutrient-rich waters from the deeper layers of the ocean up to the surface, a phenomenon that also occurs in the California and Peru currents on Earth. As a result of this upwelling, the marine ecosystems along this stretch of coast will be extremely productive, with enormous blooms of plankton serving as food for innumerable species of acanthopods, thranaxarynchids, and other pelagic nekton. Plus, since on Tira 292b the tides rise almost 3 times higher than they do on Earth, as the tide ebbs, it will expose many kilometers of mudflats strewn with stands of sessile anthostomes and other reef-building organisms, as well as rock pools filled with sarcopods, tentaclostomes, and other animals that dwell within the littoral zone that will be easy to gather and harvest. With such a varied and stable food source on their doorstep, some of the neotechs living along the coast will establish permanent sedentary settlements on the shores of a bay just south of the equator, where a river flowing from the northeast empties into a marshy delta. To make the most of this landscape, these cultures will develop technologies and traditions that allow them to efficiently gather the aquatic resources around them. Aside from harpoons and nets, one way they might do this is by constructing artificial tide pools by building rock walls along stretches of the littoral zone, creating enclosures that can be precisely engineered to encourage the growth of specific species of aquatic organisms, much like the clam gardens and the estuarine root gardens constructed by the peoples of the Pacific Northwest that were respectively used to cultivate shellfish and aquatic plants. Similarly, acanthopods and other pelagic animals can be caught using fishing weirs, consisting of walls or fences built across areas of the littoral zone that trap the animals in the shallows as the tide ebbs. In human history, fishing weirs have been independently employed by an enormous variety of cultures for tens of thousands of years, and the neotechs are likely to make use of the same technology on an even greater scale, tending to their enormous tracts of weirs and tidal gardens in much the same way that farmers might manage their fields and paddocks. To go along with these weirs, some cultures in this area will also dig channels or canals that direct anadromous acanthopods into ponds near the center of the neotech settlements to make them more accessible to the inhabitants. Since the stretch of coast around the mouth of the river is prone to flooding, these canals will also play a vital role in water management, with moats and dikes that help control the water level. As a further defense against floods, any buildings in the area will need to be built on stilts or solid stone foundations, the materials for which will need to be procured further upriver and boated down to the delta. Each clan or kinship group will establish their dwellings around a shared waterway, somewhat like the irrigation communities of the Hohokam of the North American Southwest, with those around the larger channels coalescing into urban centers connected to the smaller settlements by a network of bridges, making this delta one of the most densely populated hubs of early Neotech society. Keep in mind that the areas we've examined in this video won't be home to just one homogeneous culture, but instead a rich tapestry of many different societies that vary from one another not only in the basic aspects of material culture that we've discussed here, but also in numerous other cultural elements such as societal structure, artistic traditions, and belief systems, all of which will be explored in future videos. And of course, these cultures will only be a tiny fraction of the countless thousands of societies that emerge early on in Neotech history, each with their own unique history and cultural identity. And among this profusion of early cultures, a small handful of them might find themselves under just the right conditions to see the development of agriculture, which will come with some major implications for the development of Neotech societies across the planet. But before we can talk about agriculture, first we have to cover a much broader topic. In the next episode, we'll look at how the Neotechs begin to influence the animals around them to undergo the first steps in the process of domestication. Thanks very much to Lands Unknown for all his help with putting this video together. This was my first proper foray into geography and anthropology, so it was incredibly helpful to have his guidance. Be sure to check out his channel, including the 2-hour livestream we did together that goes over some of the topics that I hope to cover in upcoming episodes. And for more on the new map, check out the video on my second channel. Thanks also to all the artists on Discord for once again providing the artwork for this episode, links to the servers in the description, and as always, a massive thanks to all the patrons, whose continued support makes videos like this possible. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.